evening, everybody. On behalf of Chemical Engineering section of ISL, I welcome all of you to the public lecture. Today, our resource person is Professor S.S. Perera. He holds BSc Engineering degree and he is a chartered chemical engineer and fellow member of ISL. He is former head of the Department of Chemical Engineering and professor of Chemical Engineering in University of Moratuwa. He also held the post of chairman of the Chemical Engineering Sectional Committee in the previous years, and this year also he is the president. Chairman of the Chemical Engineering section, and he is also a council member of ISL for last 5 years, and he is having academic and industrial experience for last 36 years. And today, Professor S.S. Perera is presenting new chemical engineering inventions, mainly. These inventions are done by himself, and I welcome Mr. Professor S.S. Perera to deliver the lecture.
Thank you very much, and sorry for the delay. I got stuck in the traffic. So actually, why we thought of this presentation was due to this reason, right? Which will be given in the next slide. I'll just read it, right? Man, the most superior organism on earth, has gradually developed this ability to understand nature and natural phenomena, understand and create artificial phenomena through research, inventions and innovations, so that man has become capable of securing most of his requirements, such as food, water, clothing, shelter, health, safety, security, raw materials, products, many types of energy, and is becoming increasingly capable of safeguarding himself against natural disasters such as earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, tsunamis, tidal waves, cyclones, typhoons, health epidemics, etc., and man-made disasters such as wars, terrorism, industrial accidents, etc. So actually, inventions and innovations are very important as depicted in this statement, because I think human beings are the kings of the animal kingdom, and due to their superiority, they have very high, you know, very high brain capacity, intelligence and ability to communicate, work as a team, and high curiosity, which causes, which leads to inventions and innovations, so that they become capable of, you know, of securing most of their requirements, and also being able to safeguard themselves against various natural disasters as well as man-made disasters, right? So actually, we have at the University of Moratuwa, we have done a lot of research, and I thought we should just give some insight into the various inventions that we have done, and actually most of these things are being used in the industry today. For example, we have developed low cost tiling systems. These are the construction field, right? Low cost tiling systems, chemical services, then emulsion, weather shield, and special paints. Anti-corrosive paints, high adhesion, low corrosion, resistant, this should be anti-corrosive paints, high adhesion, corrosion resistance, special paints of steel, cast iron, and amano. Then waterproofing materials we have developed, then waterproofing of tiled swimming pools, bathrooms without breaking tiles, then concrete cracks, crack repair chemicals, fast setting and expanding grounds, concrete curing agents, such as plasticizers, super plasticizers, then soil and peat consolidating chemical additives, which are very important in reducing cost of foundation, then flow hardeners. I will give you some slides, pictures later, but for the time being, I will just go through this fast so that we have time to give further explanations, right? We have also developed water based wood sealers, varnishers, which are patented, then tile cleaners, grout cleaners, fungus cleaners, then termite treatment chemicals, 10 to 20 year warranty, wood preservatives, rust removing chemicals, patent, then non-drying adhesives, patent pending. Then water tank leak sealing, water plugging grounds, chemical and heat resistant grounds, concrete adhesives, water resistant, waterproofing and fungus resistant tile grounds, then glass, steel, aluminium, timber adhesives, tile adhesives, tile on tile, tile on terrazzo, cement, wood, etc. Then crack resistant adhesives, additives for cement, mortar and concrete, then low cost cementitious seat insulators for roofs. And also inventions and innovations in water, environmental field, water treatment plants, chemicals, wastewater treatment plants, chemicals, hotels, wastewater treatment plants, chemicals for vehicle service stations, wastewater treatment plants and chemicals for poultry farms, cattle farms, piggeries, then special chemicals for deodorizing, cleaning, blocks in toilets, sinks, pipes, gullies, septic tanks. Then innovations and inventions in soaps, detergents, sanitizers and cleaners. For example, we have developed special low-cost manufacturing soap. Actually, we'll show you all some samples, right? Then disinfectants, sanitizers, deodorizers, and also disinfectors and, sorry, this repetition. Then we have also developed solutions for the urban solid waste problem, poultry, pig, cattle farm waste problem, which can be, you know, we have a system where we can rapidly digest urban solid waste, poultry waste and other waste and convert them into organic fertilizer, which is also a patented system. Then we can also convert, digest agricultural waste like straw, sawdust and plant waste into organic fertilizer, which is also patented. Then special deodorizers for poultry, pig and cattle farms. And we have also done some developments in the fields of medicine, where we have developed wound healing systems and things like that, right? In fact, we have developed these ADA wound healing system and other treatment systems, where we will show you some pictures of wound healing. And ADA stands for aerobic, anaerobic, disinfectant, antiseptic wound healer. And we also have developed medicines for hemorrhoid, which is being used in Sri Lanka heavily because this can cure hemorrhoids without any kind of surgery. Then wound cleaning systems and etc. And the most important thing is these formulations are do not cause any bioaccumulation. I think you will know that when you put medicines to wounds, earlier they used to put iodine and various things, and they found that they were bioaccumulative, right? And finally, what happened is most of these medicines have been taken out of shelf, and it is not being produced, right? But we have developed medicines which are, you know, very very straightforward medicines which are non-bioaccumulative, and also does not cause any genetic modifications. So genetic modification is that when you put a medicine to the wound, it will react with the cells of the, I mean, various cells that are in the body, and will form abnormal cells which can cause cancer, right? So this system works on this principle, right? They kill microorganisms and heal wounds or skin diseases by a combination of cations, sodium, potassium, calcium, magnesium and anions, chloride, OH-, NO3-, phosphate and atomic oxygen, right? So before getting into medicine part, we will get on to some of the inventions that we have done in the construction field, right? Now, when I say low-cost tiling systems, I think tiling has become the order of the day today. Everybody wants to put tiles on their floors, and this is a very expensive affair, especially if you have an old floor, right? And if you want to fix tiles, you have to break the floor, then do concreting, right? And then stabilize the floor, and then put a screed on top of it, right? And then level it, then retile. But we have developed a system where if you have an old floor, without doing any kind of breaking of surface or concrete or whatever, we have a system where we use chemicals. Now, for example, if you take this floor, which is a terrazzo floor, which has been waxed, if you want to fix tiles on it, you can't just do it, because the tiles won't adhere to the surface, right? As a result, even if you tile it after some time, it will go get, you know, separated from the surface. So what we have is a chemical system where we use a de-waxing chemical where we put the chemical and rub, and the vaccine, the flow will come out. Then we have a surface activator, which when we put, right, the surface cement becomes active, right. Actually, why the reason why tiles can't be pasted on old floors is simply because when cement is crystallizing, right, it's a three-dimensional crystallization which happens, and it leads to a monolithic mass. For example, when you put a flow concrete, right, you have to put the concrete continuously, right, because then the cement will adhere three-dimensionally. There will be crystallization of calcium silicate in three-dimensionally, so that finally you will end up with a monolithic mass. There, if you take samples from different points, you will have the same kind of chemical and physical properties, right? But if you just lay the concrete halfway and stop it, and after several days, if you try to do it again, then there will be what is called a cold joint. Cold joint is where the initial concrete that you put, the cement crystallization has stopped, because after some time, the crystallization occurs because of what you call electron insufficiency, right? So when you keep on putting your cement, it gets, you know, crystallized. The old cement, I mean the one you put earlier, will integrate with the new cement, and you will get a three-dimensional bonding, right? But if you just allow the concrete to, you know, allow it just to idle up for some time, then the surface activation goes off, and when you put, say, old cement is like this now, and when you put the new concrete, it will be like this. So it won't bond three-dimensionally, and it will lead to a crack. So that is the reason why when you put a concrete in a house or building, people keep on putting continuously, even despite frames, they just keep on pouring the concrete so that there is three-dimensional addition, right? So this old cement flow, what has happened is the cement is inactive, right? So when you put new cement mortar, it won't adhere, right? But we have developed a chemical where you apply the chemical and you make the surface active, so that next time when you put your cement mortar, it will bond again and it will get fully integrated with the old concrete, right, or cement mortar. Then we have developed basic waste treatment plants. We have developed special emulsion paints. Yeah, the traditional emulsion paints are sometimes you end up with kind of fungus and various things, discoloration and things like that. So we have incorporated certain chemicals into these paints, emulsions and weather shields. There, it will not allow fungus to form. It will not allow this separation from the substrate and things like that, which have been done on, you know, based on industrial problems that we have been encountered. Even then, we have done research and we have developed paints of that nature. And many, I think even the Unisamoto Civil Engineering Department building itself, they have used these paints. Then anti-corrosive paints, here this paint, the one of the problems that we have is most of the paints that we have are alkyd based paints, where, you know, the adhesion is poor. So after some time you get peeling off of paint, right? And this results in, now in order to prevent corrosion, you have to prevent water, then air and conductivity, right? Because water, air and conductivity leads to local cells, which, you know, due to which cause conduction of electrons, yeah, or electric current, and then the steel becomes the donor of electrons, and as a result it gets oxidized and you find corrosion. We have developed water-based anti-corrosives. There we the logic is this. Now if you take steel is inorganic, right? And when you apply alkyd or some other paint, that is inorganic, that is organic. So onto an inorganic substrate, we are applying an organic paint. And we know that inorganic is hydrophobic, right? Inorganic like steel, hydrophilic, and organic paints are hydrophobic. So when you apply hydrophobic coating to a hydrophilic surface, there is natural enmity, that is, these two are not friends. So you end up with a kind of situation where the steel doesn't want to bond with the organic material. So as a result, initially, although it looks as if it has bonded, when there is sunshine and water fall due to rain, etc., there is separation. So what we have done is we have developed a water-based anti-corrosive paint, where we have the solvent is water. Now if you take a normal paint, it will be all the ingredients in the paint will be mixed up with organic material like thinner and things like that. So thinners are basically you have alkenes, alkynes, alcohols, esters, aldehydes and things like that, which are all organic. And these don't bond properly to the steel. As a result, after some time, it separates. So when you have water base, water is inorganic, then steel is inorganic, they are friends. So when you apply paint on the steel, inorganic steel is inorganic, water is inorganic, therefore they are friends. They can, you know, wetting is better, right? As a result, after some time when it gets bonded, and despite the various vagaries of weather like sunshine, rain and all that, the separation is this. Now we have used this paint on steel which are being used in constructions close to the sea, right? And things like gates. Now gates are always exposed to sunshine and rainfall and dew, etc. And we have tested for more than 15 years, right? And we see that there is no separation. The logic is that. Logic is that. I will show you some samples application of water-based paints on steel. And the other important thing is to also water-based paints. Into water-based paints, you can dissolve various anti-corrosive or corrosion inhibiting chemicals, right? For example, zinc phosphate, zinc, various zinc materials, then things like sodium carbonate, right, which are kind of corrosion preventive materials. But for example, you can't put sodium carbonate into solvent-based paints because solvent doesn't dissolve sodium carbonate. And if you put zinc phosphate, it won't get dissolved, it will get dispersed only, right? And therefore, characteristic to prevent corrosion is less. But when you have water-based paint, you can put whatever chemicals you want, it will get dissolved. And finally, it will create a low pH, right, which is very conducive for anti-corrosion, that is, which prevents corrosion. And also, it produces special, reactive steel and produces a kind of inert layer which prevents corrosion, right? And this water-based paint, we have found that these paints are very good to apply on amano, that is zinc alum or galvanized steel, right? Once you apply, the separation is less. Then we have developed waterproofing materials and services. They are, for example, if there is a toilet in a house, which is a tile toilet in a house, there is water, from the toilet, water seeps through the slab to lower levels. The general method would be to break the tiles, remove the screed, then if there are cracks in the underlying concrete, repair cracks, then again waterproof, then again put the screed, then again level the screed, then again put tiles, right? And then again do what you call grouting of the tile and hoping for the best. But here we have a system where without removing a single tile, we can stop waterproofing by a special method we have developed. So what we do is if there are leaking toilets, what we do is we don't also have to wait till the toilet dries, right? For example, if they want us to do the repair today, we'll ask them to give us today morning, say 10 a.m., right? And then we go there, we apply a special chemical which will remove the tile grout, right? And then we also clean the what you call gullies with that chemical, where all the slime and deteriorated cement, etc., get dissolved. And they, we completely, you know, clean the gullies and pipe joints and etc. There we think water is leaking, right? Then what we do is, we have a special grout which bonds to all these, you know, tile grooves and gullies, etc. Right? We can use our fingers and hands to it. So we will keep on applying that grout to all the tile grooves. And then inside the, I mean, major points of leaks are gullies, right? So we, using fingers, we fill all the pipe joints. Yeah, they are the, generally what happens, you know, in a gully, you will find a big, you know, deterioration, I mean, decayed cement around the pipe. So we fill all that. Then after 15-20 minutes, it gets dried up. Then we have developed a special liquid called liquid silica, right? And normally, the normally silicon is used to seal doors and window to masonry joints, then glass to you know this especially these steel and aluminium windows. You find that water creeps through all these joints. So what they put silicon, which is a rubber. Now in our case, we have developed silicon, which is a liquid, right? So after you do all the grouting, we apply liquid silicon with a brush on the grooves and gullies and all that. It will penetrate into the material and then it will seal off. So next time when you put water, it won't go in, right? So it's very fast. So for example, if you are given a bathroom, say 10 by 10 or 10 by 20 feet. And we also waterproof the walls as well, because if people keep on bathing for 10-15 years, water invariably goes through wall. Grout and you know gets into the walls and causes discoloration of paint in the wall. But when you put this, when you apply the liquid silicon, it stops completely. Now one example where we have done this is the general hospital cardiology unit, which was built about 10 years back. Then for almost 4-5 years they couldn't use it, right? Because the waterproofing was poor and water was leaking. And for example, there are large numbers of bathrooms, because in this kind of ward, there will be hundreds of patients. So morning they take a bath, then they have to be, for example, if they have to be operated, then they are given special baths, and it's a continuous case of use of water in large quantities. So what happens is, if there are water leaks, right? Then large amounts of water seeps through the tiles, goes into the concrete and through cracks in the concrete. It will go to lower floors down south. And in this case what happened was, all the operating theater, there was water seeping through fan shafts and various electric conduits. Why? Because when this water goes into the slab, in the slab you will find conduits which are carrying electrical wires, and through those conduits water used to come down. And they could use the walls, right? So they approached, just because they knew that we have developed a system that was about 6 years back, 6 or 7 years back. So we repaired 28 bathrooms, right, in the cardiology unit within 1 month without breaking a single tile. Now what is the advantage? If they had to break the tiles and redo the bathroom, it would have cost several million, number one, right? Number two, until the entire repair is done, they can't use the hospital, right? Because you have to make the tiles and carry the debris down, right? All the debris, then there will be vibrations, right? Sound pollution, dust and debris, right? So all that they'll have to take, and they'll have to take through lifts, or people will have to carry down, and then they will have to remove all these debris by tractors and dumps somewhere. So it's a massive kind of involvement. And during that time, then none of the wards can be used, right? Because if you have dust, if you have, for example, dust in the air, it can cause what you call infections in patients who have undergone heart surgery, right? So they can't do it. So we did 28 bathrooms without breaking a single tile with this system. And up to now, they are working, right? I think recently we did the survey after 5 years, and there were leaks in 3 bathrooms. There again, what we found out that they had changed plumbing. They have removed the existing pipes and put some new pipes, and they have broken the tiles. But anyway, as charity, we said, although 5-year warranty has gone gone away, right? Now it is almost 6 years, we will do it free of charge. Now this another thing which we have developed, waterproofing or tile swimming pools, bathroom. Yeah, for example, recently we another swimming pool, some tiles had got removed from the pool, and they were saying that water can't be emptied. So it's a Olympic 50 meter by 25 meter swimming pool, and some tiles have these I think probably 15-20 years old, and tiles have broken away. So they had to fix the tiles without emptying the pool while the water was in, right? So we have redeveloped a underwater tile that you see there. We had our workers, actually what we did was, we got Navy swimmers, Navy swimmers, they went down, they removed the tiles, the old broken tiles, then what we did was, we gave this special underwater tile adhesive, we gave in syringes, right? So they filled up the syringes, they went and they applied the underwater tile grout, tile adhesive, and then they, after putting the tile grout, they put the tile and put a weight, and within 10-15 minutes it gets fixed, right? So the reason why water couldn't be removed in this swimming pool was, if they remove water, what will happen is the hydrostatic balance which they have, I mean the swimming pool is filled with millions of several hundred thousand tons of water, and if you remove, then there might be the water table underneath which will, I mean, due to the buoyancy, it might come up. Now, that is number one. Then number two is, if you remove water and if the swimming pool is exposed to sunlight, due to the heat, the existing tiles will get removed. So it will be a massive operation. So we did this. Actually, we were given a very short time to do this, but anyway, we did it. Then concrete crack repair, and this is something which is very, very important. I will show you some pictures, right? What happens is, all these buildings, right, due to poor, I think main reason is, I always recommend that each and every column, beam, etc. should be waterproofed, right? Although some of them can be interior. The reason is, there is continuous, I mean, a building should last at least 75-80-100 years. So when there is continuous rainfall, then when there is high humidity in the air, some moisture can go into the concrete beams, slabs, right, columns, etc. And they can gradually react with the steel, right? And then the steel gets corroded. Now just imagine, let's say this building has 20-30 columns, right? So if those columns get corroded, what will happen? Those columns are carrying the entire weight of this building, right? And it has to do so for 75-80-100 years, depending on the lifespan of the building, right? So when water goes in, it can go as liquid water or it can go in as moisture, right? So exposed beams and slabs, invariably water will go through as rain, right? Rain and dew. But even columns inside the building, there can be some kind of penetration of water, and they can corrode. So when it corrodes, what happens is that due to the steel expands, and due to the expansion, the addition between the steel and the cement mortar goes off, and it will, you know, large chunks of concrete or cement mortar breaks away, and steel gets exposed, and you will find when you look at those, you will find that steel is corroded, right? Now what to do? Now this is something, a column which is already holding a heavy load, right? Now this, we have developed a system where we have special corrosion removing liquids, which you can apply with a brush or spray water, then the corrosion goes off, right? Then you put a neutralizer, which will neutralize the chemical that was used, and then we spray anti-corrosion inhibitor, right? Then we have developed a rapid grout system, which adheres very fast to the concrete and the steel, right? And then you can repair the columns without any kind of major breaking. Then fast-setting expanding grout, these are some of the things which can be used For example, concrete curing agents, we know that normal concrete takes about 3 to 4 weeks to for all the chemical reactions to take place. What happens is, in Portland cement, you have dicalcium silicate, tricalcium silicate, calcium aluminate and various chemicals. When you put water, they gradually react with water and they become calcium silicate hydrate, and that is what you call cured cement. Now this reaction is slow because your concrete is solid material, there is no mixing, right? But if you put two liquids, say HCl and NaOH into a liquid and stir, within a fraction of a second, there will be, the reaction will be complete. Why? The molecules have the mobility to collide with each other and the chemical reactions to get completed fast. But in concrete, because concrete is a solid mass, right, where liquid, the molecules can't travel, the reaction is slow. So generally what happens is it takes about 3 to 4 weeks for the concrete to and cement mortar to cure. Yeah, we have developed these chemicals which can cure concrete within a few days. So these are chemicals which enhance chemical reactions, and finally the chemical reaction that took so many weeks will get completed within several days, right? Then this is another thing which we did. This research was done due to the various, you know, problems that you find in places like Handala, Vartala, where there are all the entire soil is full of organic matter. Those are called peat. So organic matter is something which can be, on which you can't build, because it is compressing, it will get compressed, then it will get decayed. So initially, let's say you are happy, you can buy the land cheap. You buy the land cheap and then you put your foundations, and then you construct the house. After a few months or weeks, you will find that the house is sinking. What is the reason? Soil is settling, right? So organic matter is settling. So this was a major problem. Actually, we did for a few people this one, right? So if they want to put up a house, they would have to completely remove this peat. Completely excavate, then fill up with non-settling material like sand or quarry dust or whatever, and then only they can repair. So what we developed, a curing agent which consolidates the peat and makes it non-reactive. Now why peat reacts is, if there is continuous ingress of water, if it reacts with water, then all these organic material like cellulose is C6H10O5, it can react with water, and if there are microorganisms, especially microorganisms will convert this cellulose C6H10O5 into carbon dioxide and water, right? And that will make the solid peat get converted, will convert it into gas, carbon dioxide and liquid water. So if you can stop that, if you can stop microorganic activity, if you don't allow the microorganisms to get in and eat the peat, that means you can prevent degradation of the soil and thereby prevent settlement. Now these are also very interesting research we did. They are these flow hardening, right? Now for example, when you do flooring, right, you can do with marble and you can do with granite, right? Granite is of course hard material, right? But if you take marble is calcium carbonate. And calcium carbonate is very, very reactive, right? Number one. Number two is calcium carbonate is very, very soft material. The hardness in the Mohs scale, that is what is called Mohs scale of hardness, right? Which talks about the hardness of the surface, right? And in the Mohs scale of hardness, calcium carbonate or marble which you apply at very, very great expense, right? I think marble is very expensive, I think per square foot. It will cost about 1,500 or even more, right? So after you put marble on your floor, if you find that the marble is getting wasted, it's a crime. Why does marble get wasted? Marble, the hardness is 2.5 or 3, right? In the outside, you know, when people walk from outside, they carry sand and various tiny particles of minerals which are which are outside. Now, for example, sand has a hardness of more than 5. So the Mohs scale of hardness is, if you take a hardness mineral pizza, mineral which has hardness 5, and rabbit on a mineral of hardness 2 or 3 or 4, right? It will, this will cause abrasion and, right, wastage of flow, right? So these are water which are there in the mercantile, tower, I think, this at Colpitty. So they had spent a lot of money on this. So what they wanted us was to develop a chemical which can increase the hardness. So we developed a chemical there which can be applied on the surface. Then there will be a chemical reaction between this calcium carbonate and the chemical that we put, and it will get converted into a mineral which has hardness about 6, right? So when it becomes 6, then in the future, if there is say sand particles coming in and abrading the surface, there won't be degradation, right? So that is the kind of research we did there. So this is another thing which we did. I think we can show you some samples. Water-based wood sealers and varnishers. Actually, we know that during the past we have been using solvent-based wood sealers and varnishers, right? If you go to a, actually this was prompted by the furniture industry in near University of Moratuwa, where I think we have the biggest biggest industrial zone, not an industrial zone, big area where the industries, main industries, furniture, and large numbers of people are employed in this furniture industry. Unfortunately, the furniture industry is not developing due to various reasons. I think lack of research. And the universities in Sri Lanka are not doing any kind of research to help the wood industry or furniture industry, right? So this is a problem. And if you look at the furniture manufacturing process, what they do is they get trees, right? They cut them, slice them using pans or other various machinery. Then they get planks. Then they size it to whatever size they want. Then they finish using circular saws and band saws and sanders and things like that. And finally, they end up with a nice piece of wood which can be used as a furniture component. But this wood has to be given a proper finish. So what they do is they apply sealer. Then they again prepare the surface with very fine sandpaper and things like that. Finally, they get to the required level. Then they have to apply varnish or wood finish or whatever, right? So this process, if you look at this process is full of dust, right? And since all these thinners that are being used are solvent based, when they spray the thinner, the solvent gets evaporated and it gets into the atmosphere, and the people working there are inhaling all these thinner vapors, right? And a thinner, as I mentioned to you earlier, consists of various organic molecules, starting from alkanes, alkynes, then alcohols, esters, aldehydes, so all of which are toxic. So when this project was given to me, I went there and I did a complete study. So I went there from morning and I was watching what was happening. Large quantities of sealers were sprayed, and thinner was all over the place, right? And varnish was sprayed, thinners all over the place. So what does that depict? It depicts two things. One is we are using a material, for example, solvent-based sealer or varnish, where the sealer, the solvent, the role of the solvent is to, is to just mix up the various, resins and things like that which we have incorporated into the sealer or the varnish. And once you apply it on the substrate, it has to get evaporated and go off. It won't remain, right? So in other words, if you take a liter of, for example, varnish or paint, let's say solid content is 30%, right? Sorry, not even 20%, 30%, about 15 to 20%, right? 75 to 80% will be thinner, right? So that will get evaporated. So the money you are spending on the thinner is wasted. And not only is it wasted, it also causes it pollute the environment, it then causes ill health to people there. Although they will be happy. For example, this multiple furniture plant which I went, these people are working from morning 7 till about 8, 10 because they were paid based on piece rate system. So if they finish one share, they will get so much. So their objective is to maximize their earnings. So if they can, they will work till midnight and do this because they feel that the more the money they get, they can start to spend on their family and they can lead a better life. But on the other hand, they don't realize that this inhalation causes health, respiratory diseases, right? It will cause esophageal, you know, diseases, lung diseases, various things. So this prompted us to do a research on how to solve this problem. So then I thought, obviously, the best method is to have a water-based system where you mix your ingredients in water and give it as water-based sealer, water-based varnish, and then they can apply with a brush or spray. Then the what is evaporated is water. So water is non-toxic, right? So how much water goes into your respiratory system, it doesn't, there are no problems. So with this, what we have done is two things. One thing is, since we have replaced solvent with water, we are now solvent, if you look at thinner, the cost of thinner will be around 200 rupees a liter, right? Whereas water liter will be, even if you use bottled water, it will be 5-10 rupees, or you can use tap water, there is no problem, right? Which is maybe 1 cubic meter will be about 50 bucks, right? So that means 1 liter will be 1 cent, 5 cents, right? So we have replaced 250 rupee thinner with 5 cent water, right? And we find that I can show you some samples. Yeah, sample man. I should call him to bring the samples. Okay. So we have also developed things like tile cleaners, lung cleaners, fungus cleaners, which again, this fungus cleaner which just came from the Kalamu National Hospital, because they have all many surgeries, operating theater, there was a lot of fungus. There are a lot of fungus. The reason is these are air conditioned, right? So when you air condition, for example, if you air condition and make this room, say 20 degrees Celsius or say 70 degrees Celsius, whatever, the wall gets cooled, right? And then on the external surface, the temperature will be about 20 or whatever. Then the dew point is the point at which water vapor condenses, right? So the dew point is about 23, 24 degrees, right? On the outside environment, the temperature, air temperature is 20, dew point or wet cloud temperature is say 23. That means what does it mean? What it means is all the some water in the outside air will condense on the wall. So then the walls will be wet. Then there will be sunshine around. So that is a kind of what happens is fungus formation is photosynthesis. Photosynthesis is where carbon dioxide and water in the environment, right, converted into glucose by plant material with the help of sunshine. So what will happen is you will have slime, right? And fungus is bad. Why? Fungus is a big organism. If fungus goes into your head, it can cause dandruff. If it goes into your ear, it can cause major infections, right? If it goes into through your nose, it can even damage the brain. Now, I met a person recently who is a very, very experienced telecommunication engineer working for Sierra or some company, and he has lost his eye. Then he came to me, because I make some medicines. So he came to me and he asked me what happened. Doctors have diagnosed it as a fungus getting into his nose, but this happens very, very rarely, right? Probability of that occurring will be very low, maybe 0.000, so many million, one per so many millions. But this fungus has gone in and it has damaged the optical nerve, right? And he can't see and he can't even lift. One eye is permanently closed. My brother is a neurosurgeon, so I sent him to him. I don't know what he's doing, but maybe he will try his level best to do something. But anyway, damage was done. The reason is some of these things, for example, fungus, right? And he is a person who has been working under pipe, digging, and telecommunication means you have to lay cables and things like that, and in very, very, very adverse conditions, right? Now, these are good preservatives we have developed, then rust removing chemicals. Now, these are also very good thing, because normally what happens is if you want to remove rust, somebody has to bring a water sand paper and keep on rubbing the surface till the rust goes off, no? So it will take maybe to clean 5 square feet of steel, that fellow will take 5-6 days, right? But with this rust removing chemical, you just apply, within a few minutes the rust will get dissolved, and then you can wash it off, and then you can apply corrosion inhibitor, and you can apply our water-based anti-corrosive, right? Now these are something which we have developed. We have, for example, water tank leaks. Let's say there is a massive water tank, right? There is a massive water tank, which water is leaking, right? And that tank is supplying water to the entire city, right? Now what to do? Can you remove water and do the repair? You can't. So you have to use special water plugging materials. So we have developed this and we have sealed many water tanks with this. For example, water tank at Ketumati, the water tank at Pandur Base Hospital, then water tanks in Blumendal Flats, Wolfendal Flats, and in many places there, without disrupting the water supply to the community, we were able to stop the leaks. Then chemical and heat resistant grounds, which happens in factories where, for example, they install a furnace or something and the surrounding area gets heated up, and if you don't have heat resistant grout, or sometimes the grout will get disengaged and tiles will break and things like that. Then concrete adhesives, sometimes you need concrete adhesives, which again I'll show you, because for example we did this project at Cinnamon Grand car park. The Cinnamon Grand car park, the concrete was damaged because all the time vehicles were moving up and down, and outside the crescent there was a road which was connecting the Gaul road to the duplication road, right? So many vehicles were travelling, even lorries were going, and the road was getting damaged all the time, right? So we use this special material, right? Concrete adhesive. So here what we do is we mix the liquid polymer with concrete or cement mortar, depending on the requirement. But of course, cement mortar, right? We mix up and then lay on it, and then it bonds. Because the reason is concrete can't carry, cement and concrete doesn't have tensile strength. They have only compressive strength. So you can build columns and various things with cement, provided the tension is taken by the steel, right? But in a road, you can't put large amounts of steel, right? And especially you have a tarred road, then you can only put about 2 inches of top finish. So here what we did was we used the concrete adhesive. So what it does is it gives tensile strength, it increases the bonding, as well as it gives a tension, some kind of tension resistance to the concrete. And I'll show you a slide. So likewise, now crack resistant adhesive of cement. Now this type happens especially, now there is this modern, people want to make their floors, right, to be more nature oriented as well as strong, and various things. For example, some people, they put concrete and then they cut, so that when you cut, the stones get exposed and you get some kind of design, right? That is number one. Number two is another set of people, they put titanium floors, right? So titanium floor means mixing titanium dioxide with cement, right? And then applying a thin layer of titanium cement finish, right? But the problem is, as I mentioned earlier, cement doesn't have tensile strength, right? So when you do finish that of that nature, after some time there will be cobwebs. Now there will be small kind of hairline cracks, right? So finally, that is a dilemma faced by most of the people who have put titanium floors. We have developed a chemical where we mix the polymer with the cement and the titanium, right? And in titanium floor, there is another thing, right? Now, dispersion of titanium in cement properly is very important. If you don't disturb this titanium in the cement, what will happen is you will have light patches and dark patches. Places where titanium is more, you will have light white patches, right? But where it has not been mixed properly, you will find different colors. So there will be color variation on the entire flow. So we have developed a dispersant where what you have to do is you have to disperse the titanium in that liquid first, and then only you have to mix in the cement, and then you have to put the polymer, and then you put the polymer when it gets cured, there will be the hairline cracks and cobwebs due to the simple reason that now the cement has tensile strength and it doesn't break, right? So that's something which we have done recently, right? Then low cost cementitious heat insulators are used. Now this is something which when we did waterproofing, we found this, right? What happened was, some of these architects, they recommend that when you put concrete roof slabs, right, to put polystyrene heat insulators and then put another sheet on top. The reason is they want heat insulation because, for example, if the room underneath is air conditioned, their air conditioning costs, etc. goes down, and on the other hand, even if there is no air conditioning, the comfort level is increased because otherwise the solar heat will get transmitted to the rooms downstairs. So they put polystyrene slabs, and we have seen that wherever they have put polystyrene slabs, the surface creep breaks and water goes in, right? And then there are continuous water leaks through these slabs, right? So what we did was, we thought that the best thing would be to make the cement itself heat insulating, right? So actually this material we couldn't use yet. So this is something where we incorporate certain things into the concrete itself, the top layer, so that the concrete itself becomes heat insulation, right? So that there is no need to put polystyrene and various things. And we have also developed water treatment plants, chemicals, wastewater treatment plants. Actually, I have done several consultancies on this, and waste treatment plants and chemicals of vehicle service stations. Now, these are specialty. Because vehicle service stations, you have oils and various things, and the Sri Lanka standard, or say environmental standard for this is very, very low amount of ppm of oil in water. So, the wastewater that they dispose should have very, very low oil. I think it's about less than 10 ppm, right? But most of these oils get mixed up in the water. What is the reason? When they wash the car, they use surfactants, right? They use various car washers, which are surfactants, right? And then this water goes into the tank. Then they spray kerosene and undercarriage various oils, and then they also discharge the waste oil in the gearbox or engine, right? The engine gearbox or wherever, and all these some of it gets mixed up. And surfactant is something which can dissolve oil in water. So finally, due to the influence of surfactants, oil gets dissolved in water, and our wastewater has oil dissolved, kind of. Now what happens is you take your wastewater, you put coagulating chemicals like alum or polyaluminium chloride, then you put flocculating chemicals, and then you get all the solid materials and suspended solids, right, disengage from water, and either they will settle down or they will get float like what you have in a kind of flotation cell. But the oil remains. So that is our problem. There we had there was a massive service station which couldn't get environmental license because of their oil level in the water. So very reputed environmental engineer came to me and asked me to develop a chemical. So we developed a chemical there. We put it and the oil went down, right? Now these are another very important this thing which we did. Wastewater treatment plants. Now I think everybody know that the poultry and cattle and piggeries are very very smelly. High protein level in wastewater, right? And many farms have to be closed down. Why? Under the Public Nuisance Act. If you have some an industry here and it gives bad smell, then the people in the vicinity, right, neighbors can go and complain to the police and police will take action against this company in the magistrate court under Public Nuisance Act. And under the Public Nuisance Act, the plant can be closed immediately, right? What they are saying is, people are more important than another set of people doing business and earning money, right? So this happened. So we have developed a chemical which reduces organic matter, and also the most important thing is this: special chemicals are deodorizing, and their kilns are using this. Right? They also had a problem with their wastewater treatment plants, where this spill led to complaints by neighbors as well as guests. Now, imagine you have a 5-star tourist hotel where you are charging $200 per day from a tourist, right? And the tourist is getting a bad smell from the wastewater system, right? So they will complain first, and they will even seek compensation, saying that they came for a holiday, they spent this money, and in good faith they came. They expected a right, fantastic atmosphere, fantastic environment, but finally they are getting a bad smell, and they can even sue for damages. So we developed this, and it will be used in several cinnamon hotels, right? So these are the man arranged on them. Aramateka, whatever. Now, actually, these are, and I will just give the logic behind the whole thing, right? Soap manufacturing plants are very expensive, right? Only a few people can put up a soap plant, no? Agreed, our chemical engineers. What do you all say? You need several hundred million rupees to put up a small soap plant. But we have developed a system where you can produce soap domestically at a low cost, right? So in this case, now for example, normal soap plant, you will need boilers to heat, right? Then you will need big soap kettles and things like that to fire the furnace or saponification to take place. Then it will have to be the various, lee and soap and all that will have to be separated. Then they'll have to be put into a kind of, we have our Unilever, former Unilever, senior most Unilever person, Mr. Valhenge, former chairman of chemical engineering section, as well as, now I think Shell has regional health and safety and environment manager. So he will probably give more ideas later. So we have that problem, right? So with our system, what we are doing, we don't have boilers, right? We have now. Actually, why the boilers are required is, if you want, since you have to generate heat. So we have developed a chemical where we carry out the saponification reaction without any external heating, right? Where we get the chemical reaction to supply heat, and the soap mixture will be in a boil, and all the saponification reactions will be completed. Then you can, there again what we have done is, after the saponification reaction is over, right, or 90-95% is over, you put the soap, liquid soap, into a PVC pipe. That will be your mold, right? So then you will get circular bar, right, which you can cut, and only thing is, it won't be a rectangular bar, it will be a circular bar. The reason is, pipes are available all over the place. You can buy a 3-inch pipe or 6-inch pipe or whatever from the hardware, that will be your soap mold, right? So you put into that, you get a cylindrical soap, you cut, and you get, that will be your soap, right? Whereas else, you will have to have wooden molds and various things, and you have to put into them. So we have Atiyad, I mean, we have made the soap manufacturing process very easy and cheap. Now this is something which we did, actually this I have a patent about from 2002, where we have, I have developed the method of converting all types of organic waste into organic fertilizer within one day using a special digestive fluid, right? Okay, I think now is the time to give some pictures. I will do it very fast, right? This is the soap which I was making for the Java committee. Actually, these I will just show a few pictures very fast, right? The basement of the, these are the basement of cinnamon granite, right? Where water was leaking, right, from all these beams and columns. So all these were the leaks from the roof, right? Now, for example, you can see these spikes. These are calcium carbonate spikes due to water seeping through the concrete and dissolving calcium hydroxide in the concrete, and as soon as it comes out, it aqueous calcium hydroxide will react with carbon dioxide and will become calcium carbonate, right? And it will solidify. So all these are major column problems, right? Actually this flow was done with, I said, concrete adhesive, right? This flow had broken due to traffic. Now we did this repair, that is, we used concrete, we put the adhesive, that is a polymer, and now it is almost 2.5 to about 2 years. There are no cracks or anything, right? The reason was the concrete on the surface, which was a brittle material, has been converted into an elastic a material which can withstand tension, right? So I will go fast because there is no time, right? So all these are leaks. Now we have repaired, I think, almost all. Now there are 1 or 2 leaks which we have to do, which have recently. So you can see the various. Now what is the main problem with this? Now, cinnamon granite is a massive multi-story building where the loads, etc., dependent on the strength of all these concrete columns and beams. And if the strength gets compromised, you will have major cracks, and then there will be what you call instability, and there will be more load on all these joints which separate, and then it can cause a kind of failure, right? Right. That is. Now these are very very expensive house, right? Where they had constructed the swimming pool. These are another section of the road which we mentioned, right? Where this concrete has been laid with a special polymer, and these are almost 2.5 to 3 years old, and you don't see any cracks, right? This is about 15,000 to 20,000 square foot area, right? Now this is a swimming pool, right? From the day the swimming pool was constructed, there are water leaks, right? Now these are very, 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 very rich man's house, I think. The cost of the building would have been more than 200-300 million, right? And so we have done this repair, right? So various problems, and now here is the repair that we did, where we had now his swimming pool. The tiled area was leaking, right? Whenever there was there were rains, water was going through the tiled area and going through the slab and going into the house, right? So we used this special method where we cleaned the grout and we applied the special grout and applied liquid silicon, which caused adhesion, right? So these are very without removing tiles. Now if we had to remove tiles, because his problem was below these tiles he had put polystyrene, because he wanted, his house was air conditioned, so he had put polystyrene under the tiles, and then what happened was water went through the tiles and got into the polystyrene, which is a void space, and the entire volume got pondered full of water, and the water was slowly creeping into the underlying concrete. So all these were actually, although he had spent about 200-300 million, he didn't have any kind of peace of mind, because water was leaking all the time. So then he wanted to remove the tiles and redo. Then we said that we will do it, and we have done it now. So he has saved a large amount of money. So this is the swimming pool, right? So without removing tiles, we have done it. Otherwise, it would have been a major construction, and this floor was on the fourth floor, right? So imagine having to break the tiles and do everything, right? The job would have been a very difficult thing, right? So we'll get on to another subject, right? So actually now what we have done is we have, I told you all that we have this waste treatment system, right? We have developed this waste treatment system. I'll do show a now these are things which we did. We have developed a digestive fluid where, for example, urban solid waste problem and the organic waste problem is a major problem, right? For example, city of Colombo, we are generating more than 1,000 tons of urban solid waste, and there is no method to treat it. Therefore, we go and dump all over the place. Now, the latest dump of all Colombo city garbage is behind the University of Moratuwa. That is called Kharadiana. Now, already mountains and mountains of garbage has got piled up, and during night, since I am about 1 kilometer from that place, I am getting the smell, right? Sometimes when I wake and go out into the garden, massive smell. So we have developed a system where I got the patent in 2002, but some now are in use, right? Where we have developed a system to convert all types of waste into organic fertilizer within one day, right? So that I will show you. Now these are demonstrations that we did at Mahavaya Mayangana in collaboration with the civil engineering department, right? So here I train farmers to convert their waste into organic fertilizer. This in a place called Nilloya, right? So what we did was we converted all types of organic waste. Now these fish waste and organic waste, right? And what we did was we used our digestive fluid. The logic behind the digestive fluid is this. Now we have organic waste generated in cities consisting of perishable waste like plant and animal waste. So what happens is these people go and dump the waste into open dumps, right? And where they expect elements of nature like sun, light, rain, groundwater, earth and microorganisms to digest it. But to tell you the truth, I visited the world's biggest sanitary landfill in USA in Philadelphia, right? There they used to get 20,000 tons of clothes or waste per day, right? They charged $56 per ton of garbage, which was sorted garbage, because all those houses in USA, they have to separate their perishable waste, organic waste and other waste. So all these organic waste are collected and they are transported to sanitary landfills like Philadelphia, where at the gate they charge $56 per ton. That was in 2006. So $56 per ton. They dig a big hole on earth, then they put bentonite clay and make the bottom impervious. Then they go and dump the waste, right? And then after some time they stamp the waste with heavy machinery and make several feet into 1 or 2 inches. And then they keep on doing it, and then after some time, the surface level, they cover, they cap it, and then they go grass and all that, and that is the end of the race. But waste is there, right? So I asked that was called We Elaborator Solid Waste Central Landfill. Then I asked the manager how long it takes for this waste to get converted into compost or whatever, right? He was a person with 25 years experience. You know what he said? He said it will take anything between nine months and 2.5 to 3 years, right? If the moisture content in the soil is more than 50%, it will get degraded in 9 months. But if the moisture content is less than 50%, it will take more than 2.5 years. So in other words, what we are doing is we are putting this waste, it is remaining in the land for more than 1-2 years. And what is happening now? Sanitary landfills, of course, you even below the earth, it doesn't cause any nuisance to people. But if you put your waste on the surface of the earth, what will happen? There will be bad odor, there will be surface runoff, if there is rain, some of these waste will get dissolved and go all over the place. And this waste obviously has microorganisms, that is pathogenic bacteria and microorganisms which are bad for health, right? And also, it completely ruins the aesthetic beauty of the land, no? When you wake up in the morning and when you open the window, do you want to see a several hundred feet food garbage pile? So your aesthetic aspect, everything goes off, right? So what we have done is now When I did this research, I was logically analyzing. Now, what is the reason? We, human being, a big organism, collectively, several million in city of Colombo, is generating several thousands of garbage each day, and we are expecting microorganisms to digest it, right? At the other end, human beings are generating garbage, microorganism and infinitesimal microorganism can't digest, no? It will take so many years. But when you eat food, what happens? When we eat food, whatever food that we eat, carbohydrate, fat, protein, whatever, when you eat food, within 4 hours it gets digested. So the reason is there is digestive fluid inside our digestive system which can digest everything, right? So what I developed a digestive fluid. So what happens is, I put the digestive fluid to this carbohydrate, fat, protein, whatever waste, right? Then it will digest this waste within whatever time I want. If I put small amount, it will take several days, right? If I put a large amount, even within 1 hour, I can digest. So this is what we are trying to show. So we have taken fish waste and various types of organic fish, this waste, right? Then, so these are the various raw materials that have to be used, right? So this Professor Tishan Jayasinghe, head of civil engineering, and this Mr. U.S. Karnaratna from CECB, Central Engineering, myself, right? So these are the farmers, they have about several hundred farmers. So what we did was, we put this digestive fluid which is called delta D, right? And then he is put in the digestive fluid, right? Then mixing with a pool, right? Because farmers don't have machines. So mixers, so the photographer hasn't done a proper job, so. And finally, this fish waste, everything becomes a slurry, right? It happens within a few minutes, depending on the amount that you put. Then after some time, we can put things like lirisidia, leaves, right? So they have plucked leaves from all the surrounding area, and they are putting, right? So we are mixing now, right? Then after some time, the digestion is over. Now what we do is, we put minerals available in the area, right? These dolomite, we are putting dolomite, right? Then we mix. Then we put epaule phosphate. This brown material is epaule phosphate. So we mix that also, right? Then we mix. So it takes some time, right? Maybe 1 hour, right? After some time, everything reacts and you get something like this, right? So digested fish waste, digested plant leaves, everything, right? And then finally, we brought some sawdust, and we put some sawdust, and now we have this organic fertilizer, right? Now what is the advantage? Unlike normal organic fertilizer, this is a very, very high nutrition organic fertilizer. Because we put fish waste, right? So fish waste means fish blood, flesh, bones, everything is there. That is, in other words, you have carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, right, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium. When you put dolomite, you get calcium. When you put epaule phosphate, you get again phosphorus. When you put sawdust, carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, so you get a peak mass. Actually, with 4 liters of delta D, you can make about 100-150 kilos of waste, the organic fertilizer. And we distributed this. Now, this is the final organic fertilizer. And this happened within maybe 1 or 2 hours, right? And we trained these farmers, and subsequently they started doing it, right? The advantage is this. The fertilizer can be made from all your waste material, right? And plant leaves, which are available. Now, if you want to make urea in Sri Lanka, you will need natural gas or naphtha, right? Which are petroleum products. Since Sri Lanka doesn't have natural gas and petroleum, maybe in the future we might have. For the time being, we can't make urea. So, in other words, we'll have to import urea from Ukraine and other countries. In fact, I spoke to the fertilizer secretariat. They were saying they had to order 12,500 tons of urea at once. So, and they were ordering from Ukraine. So, it takes several weeks to come here. Then you have to unload. Then you have to store in your warehouses, then again you have to load into lorries, then transport hundreds of kilometers to deliver it to the farmers, right? So massive operation. One thing is raw material, importing, which takes time, then logistics, right? Transport, everything which that amounts to, say, so many, 70,000-80,000 rupees a ton. And the government is importing urea and selling to the farmers at 70,000-80,000. That is their cost. But they, because of the election pledges, because they said they will supply urea at 350 per bag, they are selling at 350 per bag. Now 350 is 50 kilo bag, 350. So in other words, one ton will be 20 bags, 7,000 rupees. So they are importing at 70,000 and selling at 7,000. The government is losing 60,000-80,000 tons per rupees per ton, and the annual subsidies around 30-40 billion, right? 30-40 billion. But here is a situation where they can make their fertilizer using plant waste, animal waste, which is available. Unlike natural gas and petroleum, which is not available, these material is available. And when you take all these, cut your grass and wild, wildly growing foliage, right, vulpality, you are cleaning the environment and using that material to produce fertilizer, which is organic, which is more healthy than urea, right? So these, so finally we ended up, so actually, I will show another simple thing which I will give you. Now with this system, I may told you all that we can convert straw into fertilizer, right? Now we are a paddy growing country, and we are cultivating, we are producing 2.5 million tons of straw, right? We are producing 2.5 million tons of straw, and we are getting as a byproduct 5 million tons of paddy straw, right? So we are getting rice 2.5 million tons, we are getting paddy straw 5 million tons. What is happening to the paddy straw? People are burning it, farmers are burning. We did a study. I got my students to do a project, right? They found that all the paddy straw was being burned. What is the reason? Reason is, you can't store paddy straw, right? When you store paddy straw, it occupies land, and the biggest danger is, when you put a, when you have a pile of paddy straw, various, you know, pests, like frogs and rats get into the paddy, the straw pile, and snakes go into the straw pile to eat them. So let's say you have the house like this, and you have a straw pile like that. Then straw pile attracts snakes, and your wife and children, the farmer goes to the farm, paddy field, wife and children are walking around, children are playing, the children get bit by snakes, right? And with this new machine, paddy straw falls into the paddy field, right? And the paddy straw doesn't get digested. So when you plough or use tractors and prepare the soil, paddy straw pieces are in the soil, and they cause anaerobic microorganism digestion. And anaerobic microorganisms are bad for plants, because they can enter through the root system into plants and rot the plant, right? So farmers don't like it, they just burn it. And in fact, I was in India presenting a paper like this, and Indians were saying that they were burning 250 million tons. We are burning 5 million tons. And our survey showed China is burning 500 million tons, right? Because they feel that paddy straw is of no use. But we have developed the digestive system. And the reason is paddy straw is of no use because very light. If you put if you take a 50 kilo bag of empty rice bag, and put straw, you can't even put 1 kilo. So that means, although this farmer has large amount of straw, he can't transport. It is not viable, right? Because he will be able to put, say, 10 ton lorry, he can't put even 500 kilos of straw, right? So the reason is low density, right? But we have developed a digestive plant which can digest straw within 1 day, 1 or 2 days. So what we do is we take this liquid, which is called LRD, we mix it 50 liters of water, we spray on 50 kilos of paddy, and when it is exposed to 1 or 2 days, it becomes a powder. That is the powder which I showed you all. Now, what are the advantages of this powder? It can be used as cattle feed, like punnaku, right? You can mix it for water and give, right? So basically you are getting free of charge, right? Then you can use that to convert it into organic fertilizer, because unlike putting straw, you can put this this powder, it will get digested fast and it can be absorbed by the plant, right? Another thing is we can use this as a substitute for coal. Now here we have coal power plant, we are importing several million tons of coal. The coal is like a rock, you have to import, you have to grind it to very fine powder, then you have to spray into the furnace, then it will get burnt, right? And the cost is very high because you have to import coal, grind the coal, then store the coal, right, and use it. But here is the thing, where you have a powder, you can convert your 5 million tons of straw into powder, and it can be sprayed into the furnace and it can be burned. The other point is, coal has a gross calorific value of 6,000. 6,000 kilocalories per kilogram. And paddy straw has around 5,000 kilocalories per kilogram. So, calorific value is more or less the same. If you look at the logistics of importing through ships, loading, unloading, then grinding, doing all the value addition, this will be something which can be done by each and every farmer. If he wants to use it as organic fertilizer, he can use it. If he wants to give it as cattle feed, he can do it. Or if he feels that he has more, and if he wants to supply it to Moratuwa power plant, he can give it. Only difference is, unlike straw which can fill up, if you fill up a 50 kilo bag, you can put only 1 kilo. This powder you can put 30 kilos. So now the transport, efficiency of transport and viability of transport is increased, because you can put 30 kilos, right? So in other words, what we have done is, we have converted it to a powder which has a higher density, and when you put it into a 50 kilo bag of you can put 30 kilos. Now, earlier your 10-ton lorry couldn't carry even 500 kilos. Now maybe you can carry about 30 times that. Right? So, may not be 30, maybe 5,000-7,000 tons you can carry. Right, so we have, I will just show you a few more pictures. I think you will be interested in our medical research, right? Actually, we have developed medicines for wound healing, where we have developed medicines for diabetic wounds, bed sores, all types of wounds, chronic wounds, and all types of rashes, eczema, dermatitis, right? Then psoriasis and white spot. Again, kasili, dadakushta, tuala, potu kabara, sudu kabara. One of the next one we developed is called ADA wound healing system, right? I will show you all some photos and we'll finish it off. So these we have the classification ADA1. Aerobic anaerobic disinfectant, antiseptic one is for highly infected wounds, for less infection and things like that. Then we have this system for itching, scratching, rashes, eczema and dandruff. These are very, 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 very strong rashes. There is a university chap who had been having psoriasis for so many years. He had undergone treatment, Ayurvedic, everything. Now he has started using our medicine, and within 2 weeks he has almost got cured. These are adenovirus treatment. These are things which are developed. My background is, my brother and all these people are doctors, and I have also studied a bit of biomedical engineering, biomedicine, and we have developed this adenovirus treatment. For example, if you come to my house, you can see a letter issued given by somebody, right? Regional manager of Oral Development Board. He had been having hemorrhoids from 14 years. His father was Ayurvedic. he used Ayurvedic medicine for so many years, then he underwent 3 surgeries and he didn't get cured. He used this medicine and within 2 or 3 months he got cured. Then he went and got his system examined by the surgeon who he had undergone 3 surgeries. So he went to the same surgeon. He got him to do a endoscopy and study the whole thing. Then he said all his hemorrhoids have got dried up and there was no need for him to take medicine. These are dental health. So I think there are very limited number of medicines for mouth infections. The reason is mouth is something where you eat and you can't put toxic medicines into your mouth. We have developed this system where you can any kind of lip wound, gum wound, rotten teeth, and especially when you have toothache, you can use this. What you have to do is you have to, if you have gum disease, just take this into bitter cotton bud and apply 2 to 3 days, 2 to 3 times a day, and after 10 minutes wash the mouth, and within a few days, within 1 or 2 days, your gums will get, all your wounds will get cured. Then if there is plaques and discoloration, this will make your teeth whiter, and also if there are root rot, you can apply, and even bad smell. And these electrogel, these are arthritis, rheumatism, osteoarthritis, osteoporosis, all kinds of sprains, cramps, cartilage, ligament, tendon, tissue injuries, locked fingers, locked joints, numbness and nervousness. It's also good for Parkinson's. So here, this has cured a large number of people, and I am happy to say that vice chairman of the agency is also using it, and also Channa Vijayavardhana, famous dancer who has who had been dancing all the time, his knees have got wasted and he has been requested to replace his knees, which would cost about 20 lakhs in Singapore, and he's using this and he has got cured to a great extent. These for skin gel, for skin discoloration and roughness. Then hair gel is for hair loss. And this is another invention which we have made, which is varicose gel, which is for varicose, right? Now varicose veins are situations where the main veins in your leg are blocked and peripheral capillaries are used to transport used blood. So the solution is operation, surgery and removal of veins. We have this system where we have varicose gel and anti-flam. What we have to do is we have to apply varicose gel 3 times a day on anybody, on areas where varicose veins are apparent, and apply on the varicose veins as well as the surrounding muscle, and then after 10 minutes you have to apply anti-flam, right? And even people who have not been able to get cured with surgery, get cured at the UMTA. We have several people who have used it. These are fat gel. These are also very good gel. If you have stomach fat, some people walk for 10, 15, 20 kilometers, and what happens? Stomach doesn't go down, but their knees get wasted and they develop arthritis. Because the stomach muscle you can't exercise, right? When you walk, your leg muscles, thigh muscles, calf muscles are working, but the stomach muscle doesn't work. Therefore, unless there is work, there is no energy dissipation, right? So with this fat gel, when you apply three times a day, and you can do simple exercises. Once in 10 minutes, you do 10 times, that is, taking your stomach in and putting out, you will find that within 2-3 weeks, several inches will go off, right? Right, so I think if you are interested in some boons, I will just show it to you all in 2 minutes, right? In fact, these I told you all that we have developed diabetic medicines or diabetic food mixtures and things like that. Now, these patient whose son was a doctor, right? And his father underwent bypass surgery at cardiology, right? Then, you know, the bypass, the vessel is taken from the calf, leg. So they took two vessels from the one vessel from the leg and did the bypass. And what happened was the wounds didn't get healed up. So he was in hospital for almost 5 months because he developed the bed sore and he was not getting healed up. So this chap was very, very upset. Then somebody had told that we have developed a medicine. He came and took the medicine. And he had, I told him not to stay in the hospital. Your hospital is putting betadine and various medicines which doesn't cure the wound. So he took the, I told him to take the patient to his house and for him to treat the wound, right, with this medicine. So actually he's not there. Now these are some wounds which we have healed, right. So I will just show you all some wounds. This is not the picture which I want to show you all. So, these are massive wounds which are diabetic wounds, right? And diabetic wounds, why these wounds don't get healed is they are very large, number one. Number two is there is a very, very strong microorganism. There are two microorganisms. One is Pseudomonas, right? The other one is Staphylococcus. Now, if you eat these two organisms get into your wound, you can treat for several months or years with the traditional medicines like betadine and fusidine, it won't get cured. Right? So I don't want to stress you all with Right. So these are the pictures taken by the doctor on his father's wound, right? So he had taken, very diligently he had taken photos from day one, right? So these are the wound caused by removal of the vessel, right? So these are the situation after 4 or 5 months, right? So now he started applying the medicine. Now you can see that there is gradual contraction of the wound, right? You can see the periphery coming in. And these are the bed sores he had. His father, the doctor's father had a 3 inch deep bed sore, right? Which was a cavity. Now he started applying the medicine, right? So now you can see, now gradually the wound is contracting, right? So there is a kind of periphery is going in. Now this is also gradually going in. Now this is also, you know, from the sides it's getting healed up. Now you can see. Now you can see, right? Now the wound is very small, right? So I am happy to know that within 1 month, the wounds got healed up. And this step is no other than who? Secretary of Mahajan Exapiruna, this patient. So he said he will come to any forum and he will explain the plight he was in. And actually they have thought that when a person gets a bed sore, very difficult to cure because it goes in, no? And some people die straight away out of the bed sore, right? Now I will show you a few shots of, now these are cancer patients, right? These are called anal cancer, right? So these are like, you know, cauliflowers, big, it grows very fast, right? So patients, you know, this kind of patient, they just keep medicine, put medicine all that the whole time. Very, very smelly, very, very uncomfortable for the patients as well as surrounding patients who get a very bad smell, right? So one doctor, Samadhi Rajbakshi, he's a very, very, you know, he's a Buddhist, very, very highly involved Buddhist. He has studied, he has done a PhD in Buddhism as well. So he was, he wanted me to come and do this, right? So we applied this, right? These applying. And these are other wounds, right? So very fast. Today you put betadine or something, tomorrow it has grown even further. Now after applying, you can see, now the big, this thing, gradually there is contraction, right? Now it has gone further. The only problem is, now this doctor is, this back to the old ones, problem with cancer hospital is very difficult to take photos, right? So actually we want to do this in the future, but I will have to get some students, you know, all. So anyway, this is the situation. So I am very, very sorry that I took a long time. And if you want to see, you can see all the products here, right? So if you all want to ask a few questions, you can go ahead. I am sorry that I took such a long time for this.
The products that you were using, especially the one that you use for decaying sodas,
yeah.
And maybe powders, like what extent have you commercialized?
Actually, I conducted several workshops under the auspices of the Agricultural Ministry, right? And I trained more than 3,500 farmers. Because the Minister of Agriculture, Chamal Rajabaksh, the Minister, he asked me to do it. And it was done also with the in collaboration with Janata Fertilizer, which is the, you know, they have a, earlier they have the JDB, right? It was converted into Janata Fertilizer Enterprises. So I went and spent a lot of time, my young and all over the place, and I trained farmers. So what we did was, we had workshops, there were hundreds of farmers who came, so I explained what is agriculture, photosynthesis, everything. Then they brought various waste material. Then I put that and put the digestive fluid. Within several hours, we made fertilizer. We gave to farmers, right? And farmers took the fertilizer and they used. And within a few days, they realized that this fertilizer was good. How did they realize? This is another thing which I learned from farmers, right? Normally, when you put a fertilizer, it takes four, five months, no? But within 1 week, they said this fertilizer is good, they want to start the project. How did they do it? That which I learned from them. You know what they did? So they have a paddy field, they have the paddy field, no? All the paddy, the rice plants are at the same height. Then, what they did, they went and put this fertilizer in a small area. And they observed. Then they found that area, the plants were taller than the places where they had put the urea. So then, I mean, relative study, right? This area, they were taller. So they want to do it. You know what happened? Then the farmers, actually JDB, this Chandra Fertilizer, they took bank managers. Bank of Ceylon, People's Bank, all these bank managers also came. Then they registered. They said they will give farmers a loan. They can start producing this fertilizer with their waste material, and then if they have excess, they can sell. Janta Fertilizer will buy the organic fertilizer straw powder and they will sell on behalf of the farmers, right? When they want to start it, you know what happened? The scientists in the agriculture department, where they did their PhDs and all that, they had not done any research or anything. They felt jealous, right? They went and told the, you know, I don't know what they did. Anyway, there were two things. One thing was they were jealous. Number two was the fertilizer suppliers who are supplying so many hundreds of thousands of tons of urea to Sri Lanka, they realized that if the farmers start producing their own fertilizer using tamakolai, valpalati, අර වයින් නේ කෙසෙල් බඩයි කෙසෙල් කොලයි අර වයින් යන්නේ නේ නේ පොර හදුවොත් බලන්න they need to stop importing fertilizer so they went and maybe the minister also was kind of not honest man so that they went and brainwashed the minister and this project was abandoned you won't believe agriculture ministry has to pay me 350,000 for conducting workshops I went in my vehicle I took this delta D and everything I took four people for demonstrations and I didn't charge much I said for the entire works you pay me 25,000 transport demonstration this thing so they had to pay me some six maybe 500,000 bucks they paid only 100,000 or 200,000 then they want to stop it in such a way they didn't pay me the 300,000 so that I got discouraged like and I stopped That was there was whatever. But anyway, some people are using it, right? So that is how it works in Sri Lanka. The educated people are the people who block development. Because they go and, you know, they, unless they are, they have done everything themselves, they won't allow others to do it. A good example is the rice variety that we have. Now we have all useless variety of rice. Those days we had very good rice. Now if you take India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, they grow very, very valuable rice like basmati, right? However, our agricultural ministry scientists, they went and developed some rice variety. They wanted to promote their variety, right? They stopped imports. Actually, in those days, seeds were imported from India, right? They imported onion seeds, rice seeds, right? And they put and their harvest was very high. Now, recently, I met a farming from Kolundaru. Where he was saying the average yield is 60 to 8 bushels or maybe 100 bushels. I have a friend in Moratuwa who became the Govi Raja. Govi Raja under Dali Senanayaka's time and he had the certificate where he became the Govi Raja and his yield was 190 bushels per acre. He had used organic fertilizer, right? So what has happened? We have basically ruined our agriculture. Now from an acre, if you can get 160 bushels, if you are getting only 67 or 11, the farmer will become bigger in no time. So what has happened is, we don't promote, you know, high yielding varieties, high yielding, you know, methods, techniques. We just go, keep on doing the same thing all over and over again. Every day our farmers are becoming bigger. And I'll tell you very soon, we will have to stop petty cultivation because all the people are losing money. Who has to spend, you know, 4 hours, 4 days, 4 months under the sun with a loincloth? Do you want to run, make a loss? So this is what happened. But if, now we are doing it, if anybody is interested, we can give the delivery, we can give the technology, they can do it. And now several companies are doing it, actually. But island-wide, world-wide, Sri Lanka-wide, I can't do. It is the government who has to do it.